What's up, guys? This is Michael Kamalu, aka Dr. Gaines, and in this video, we're going to go over the next most requested item from those of you who have filled out my content request form, and that is the forearms. There's just something about the forearms that conveys strength, and having well-built or defined forearms can often make up for lack of build elsewhere, like upper arms, for example. After all, it's often the only part of the body that you can see besides someone's head. However, the group of muscles that we call the forearms are arguably the most complex group of muscles in the human body. There are no less than 20 muscles that are packed into that area between the elbow and the wrist. And all of them have their own unique roles with a plethora of different origination and insertion points, and with good reason. Just think of all the different intricate movements that we need to be able to do with our arms and hands. However, because of that, very few people know how to actually work your forearms in a way that will hit all the muscles that you want to in the ways that you should. But luckily, you watch Dr. Gaines' videos, so you will soon be one of them. However, because the forearms are so complex, I'm going to divide this video up into a three-part series. In this and the second video, I will cover the posterior compartment of the forearm, which are collectively called the extensors, and I'll give you science-based techniques in each for how to work them. The posterior compartment is separated from the anterior compartment by a structure called the interosseous membrane, which crosses between the ulna and the radius. And in the third video, we will go over the muscles in the anterior compartment, which are collectively called the forearm flexors. And I will give you a science-based technique I've developed to work those in that. So before jumping into today's workout technique, let's do a brief overview of the anatomy of the forearm extensors. There are 12 different muscles in the posterior compartment of the forearm. And those can be thought of as in two different categories, the superficial extensors and the deep extensors, aka the ones on top and the ones on bottom. On top, we have the brachioradialis, the extensor carpi radialis longus, the extensor carpi radialis brevis, the extensor digitorum, the extensor carpi ulnaris, the anconius, and the extensor digiti minimi. Then underneath those, we have the supinator, the abductor pollicis longus, the extensor pollicis longus, the extensor pollicis brevis, and the extensor indices. So we haven't even touched the anterior compartment yet, much less the various origination and insertion points of each muscle, but already you start to get a feel for just how complex and multifaceted the forearm muscles are. And so it follows that it takes a complex and multifaceted approach to working them and building them properly. I'll often get people commenting and trying to tell me that your exercises are too complex, that none of it really makes a difference, a contraction is a contraction, and you should just stick to the same core simple lifts and apply progressive overloading, and that's all you need. Each time I just wanna go on a 7-day rant explaining all the different scientific principles behind why that is not correct, it's inefficient and even unhealthy, and you can get just some of that on my video on non-homogeneous hypertrophy, which I will link here. But for now, just as we go over the forearms, just keep them in mind as a perfect example of why variety and complexity in your workouts are essential if you want to maximize the effectiveness of your muscle building and your health, your overall health. You'll see that very subtle changes in wrist position, in finger position, in the relative degrees of supination versus pronation, all of it makes a significant difference in which muscles are being targeted the most and how they're being targeted. But in this video, we are going to hone in on just one of those forearm extensor muscles, and that is the brachioradialis. So why does the brachioradialis of all the forearm muscles get its own video? Well, if you want to build well-defined forearms and for some reason you had to pick a single muscle to work, it would be the brachioradialis. It is by far the largest muscle of all the forearms, in both the anterior and posterior compartments. And on top of that, it's superficial. It sits right there on the top and sticks out. In fact, if you hold out your arm to your side and you grab the area just right above the elbow, what you're grabbing, that is the brachioradialis. You can feel it from both sides of the forearm. When people fold their arms, it's that muscle that bulges out on the top. But for weightlifters, there are two really unique and important aspects of the anatomy and biomechanics of the brachioradialis for you to understand and apply in your workouts. First, I'm going to show you a technique, and pretty simple one at that, that will apply and take advantage of those two principles in targeting the brachioradialis. And then afterwards, we will use the anatomy to explain what those two key principles are and how they're applied in this exercise. Let's go to the gym. This exercise, you'll be performing a variation on the reverse curl. You'll stand to where the cable is coming from one side of you, and you will be working the side that is furthest away from the cable. You will place your hand down towards the middle of your body in an overhand grip so that your forearm is pronated, and then you will flex your elbow up in a curl motion. However, instead of curling straight up, you will bring the weight up and out at an angle away from your body. And while doing this, you'll slightly supinate your forearm. Then you'll bring it back down at the same angle and repeat. All right, now to understand why this is an excellent technique for working the brachioradialis, let's take a look at those two aspects of its anatomy that I mentioned. First, notice that the brachioradialis is one of the only forearm extensors that does not cross the wrist. You'll notice that you can see the tendons of virtually all the other muscles crossing the wrist and then insert somewhere on the hand. However, the brachioradialis, it inserts right before the wrist, right at the end of the radius on the lateral edge. That's really important to understand because, unlike almost all the other forearm extensors, the brachioradialis does not actually extend the wrist or hyperextend it. In fact, it doesn't influence wrist movement at all. So if the only workouts you're doing to work the extensors, the posterior compartment of your forearm, deal with extension and hyperextension of the wrists, you are not even going to be putting load on the largest of the muscles in that compartment, the brachioradialis. The joint that it does cross is the elbow joint. You'll see that the origination point of the brachioradialis is just across the elbow, just superior to it, on what's called the lateral supracondylar ridge of the humerus. So when it contracts, it's bringing its insertion point on the edge of the radius, closer to the origination point on the lateral edge of the humerus, thus flexing the elbow. And by the way, that's how it gets its name. Brachium, the word brachium is used to refer to the upper arm, and radialis obviously refers to radius, so brachioradialis. However, this brings us to the second most important aspect of the brachioradialis to understand for weightlifters, and it's that the brachioradialis does not flex the elbow straight up evenly. Take a closer look at how the brachioradialis lies on the body. Because it originates out on the lateral edge of the humerus, when your forearm is supinated, it crosses the back of your forearm, that posterior compartment, to insert on the edge of the radius that is medial. Right? It's in the middle of your body. And in that animation, the model is actually standing with its arm supinated. So when your forearm is pronated, that angle is even more pronounced. So by starting this exercise with a pronated arm, you're actually getting some extra extension in the muscle. You're taking the insertion point and making it further away from the origination point, both with the supination and with the deviation to the middle of your body. Then when you start the contraction, that brachioradialis is going to pull on its insertion point, and that is going to bring it up, but it's also going to bring it laterally. And because that insertion point is really right on the edge of the radius, it's also going to pull your hand over. It's going to externally rotate that forearm in what we call supination. And it will supinate your forearm until it's at a neutral position. So with this exercise, you are taking max extension with the pronation and internal deviation of the arm, and then bringing it into max contraction, which is supination and the flexed elbow. Now, not all machines will allow you to rotate and slide that handle on the webbing underneath it, and so you may not be able to get, as you notice, it's not a full supination to a neutral position. But even if you're using a machine that doesn't allow that full supination, just the act of laterally displacing your arm, of bringing it up at an angle, that will result in a natural supination of the arm, so you will still get much of the benefit. Now, there is kind of a second tier to this technique that I'll have to show you in a future video, but it has to do with the fact that if you were to supinate your arm past that neutral position, then because, again, that insertion point is right on the edge, you're going to start extending the muscle again. So if your forearm was more lateral than your upper arm and supinated, then you would work the brachioradialis by flexing the arm while pronating. And pronating up until, again, that neutral point would be activating and working the brachioradialis. So this is one of those really key examples. Depending on the starting position of your arm, the brachioradialis, the same muscle contracting, can perform two completely opposite motions. One, if your forearm is starting out pronated, then it's going to be performing supination. But if your forearm is starting out supinated, it will perform pronation. Looks like little things can make a big difference, and not all contractions are the same. Guys, if you thought this video was valuable, I'd really appreciate you hitting that like button, share with your lifting buddies, and leave me a comment, as all those things will help others to find my channel. And remember that I'll be doing part 2 and 3 of these series within the next few weeks, so make sure you're subscribed and turn on those post notifications, because you will not want to miss those. And if you haven't caught on yet, I am in the process of developing comprehensive science-based online programs for every distinct muscle group in the body. That way, you can focus specifically on what you want and need without paying for and wasting time with all the rest that you don't. And one of those in development is the Maximum Gains Online Forearm Program. So if you're serious about wanting to build, develop, and strengthen your forearms, then you can add your name to the beta tester waitlist for that program, and you'll be able to try it out weeks ahead of the rest and get 50% off the program when you do. I will leave that link in the top right of your screen and in the video description below. And if you do have any other specific content requests, you have any feedback you'd like to give me, I always leave the content request and feedback form in the video description below. And if you do take the time to fill that out, you might just get a little gift from me for doing so. Mahalo, my friends. Till next time.